Yeah, I want to know, you are saying Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, is the last prophet. But how can you logically say he's the final prophet when the whole of the world, all peoples are not Muslims?
Brother, that's a very good question. When all people are not Muslim, how can you say that he is the final prophet? Brother, for a person to come as the final prophet, it's not necessary all the people should be Muslim. Allah says in Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, if he wanted, he could have created all the human beings to believe in Allah. He could have created all the human beings as Muslims. So Allah, he wanted, he could have made all unbelievers. This is a test. Allah says in Surah Mulk, chapter 67, verse number 2, Allazi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. Allah has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. If Allah wants, he can make everyone Muslims. So what Allah says, in every people we have sent a messenger. Why we say Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last prophet? Because this is the last revelation. This is the last revelation, the glorious Quran. After this, no other revelation will come. Anyone after the Quran says that he gets wahi, he gets revelation from Almighty God, he requires a psychiatrist. Because the procedure of wahi, the revelation has stopped. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the last and final messenger. Because, why? Allah says in the Quran in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 3, on this day have I perfected my religion for you, and have chosen for you Islam, and have completed my favor on you. So after the religion is completed, nothing new can be added or subtracted from the basics. So once the religion is completed, we don't require another messenger. So because the religion is complete, all what is required to be given as hidayah, as far as living in this world for the akhirah is concerned, it's complete. You don't require another messenger to come. So now it is the duty, as Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse 143, that we have made you an ummate wast, the Muslims, a middlemost community. And you have to be a witness over the others as the messenger will be a witness over you. So we have to convey the message of the last and final messenger to others. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Hajjat al-Wida, in the farewell pilgrimage speech, there were about 110,000 sahabas. He asked them, that did they deliver the message to you? All of them said, Beshak, verily you have done. He said, all those who are present here, deliver the message to those who are not present here. So it's the duty of the Muslims to do da'wah. That means convey the message. The message is complete. But Allah says in the Quran, which I quoted earlier, in Surah Sabah, chapter 34, verse number 28, Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. We have sent thee as a universal messenger, giving glad tidings and warning them against sin, but most of the human beings yet do not know. So Allah says in the Quran that most of the human beings yet do not know about Islam. So it is our duty, it is our test. It is an examination. We have to carry this message to those who don't know. That's what we are doing. This peace exhibition is one of the things. I came all the way from Bombay to Chennai to deliver my message to those people in Chennai who may not be aware. Whether you follow or not, it's not my job. Allah says in Surah Ghashiya, chapter number 88, verse number 21, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرٌ. Your job is to deliver the message. Giving hidayah, converting is not in my hands. Hidayah will come from Allah. We have to give the message. You like it, you take it. If you don't like it, no problem. So what I'm doing? Jihad, striving. Striving to convey the message to you and to the other people in the best ability, so that you come to know about the last and final messenger. So on the day of judgment, whether you accept or not, you will be witness that Brother Zakir gave me the message. If you accept, then you can say, Ya Allah Ta'ala, someone gave the message, I gave the Shahada. If you don't, on the day of judgment, you can say, there was a person from Bombay, a joker looking person wearing coat and tie, beard and a cap, he gave the message, but I didn't agree with it. So I can tell you, see, that is the person I gave the message. He didn't accept, that's not my problem. He accepts, Alhamdulillah. Hope that answers the question.
I am Chanbar Raman. In the interest of Muslim women, I raise these questions. What are the intricacies in talaq, number one? Number two, and while bigamy is an offense in Indian laws, it is not prohibited in Muslim law, number two. Third, what are the protections given to the Muslim women relating to maintenance? Number four, on the relating to common civil code.
MashaAllah. Brother, that's four in one shot. All require a lecture. Brother, four questions. Number one, what are the intricacies in talaq? Point number two, what about maintenance in Islam after divorce is talking? Number three is about polygamy. Number four is about common civil code.
The first question, what are the intricacies in talaq? There are no intricacies, very simple. Talaq, very simple. People have made intricacies in it. The procedure for talaq is given in the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. There's a full surah by the name of Talaq, chapter number 65. So if you read Surah Talaq, chapter 65, verse number 1 to 7, and Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 228 to 242, it gives details of talaq. In short, talaq is mutually agreed upon. There are different types of talaq broadly. One is by mutual agreement of both husband and wife. They both agree to part. Second type, it is unilaterally by the husband. He wants to give talaq. Point number three, third type, that if it's mentioned in the nikah nama, that the wife too can give unilateral divorce, she can give. It's known as isma or talaq etawfi. You can refer to my video cassette for details. Fourth type, if the husband is not giving her rights, and if it's not mentioned in the nikah nama, she can go to a qazi and do nikah fask. And the fifth type is, the husband may be good, but she doesn't want to live with the husband. She can request the husband to give talaq, it's known as qulah. So basically five types. The general type of talaq is mentioned in the Quran. It says that if there is a problem between the husband and wife, there should be a meeting between the husband and wife. Not that if she's putting too much salt, you say talaq, 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 and that's finished. If you don't like too much salt in your food, you tell your wife, don't put too much salt, and the problem is solved. So mutually sit together and solve the problem. If it's not solved mutually together, Allah says in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 35, appoint an arbiter, one from the wife's side, one from the husband's side. Appoint an arbiter and try and solve the problem. You know, one person from the wife's side, elderly person, one person from the husband's side, sit together, what's the problem? Yet if the problem is not getting solved, then the Quran says that you can warn her if she's not behaving, if she's not giving the duties of a wife, you can warn her, you can separate from the bed, etc. And finally, after all these procedures, then the man can pronounce talaq. When you pronounce talaq, Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 228, it says that once you pronounce talaq, wait for 3 monthly periods. So you have to wait for 3 monthly periods. Unfortunately, what the non-Muslim is asking question, I know, is talking about, can you give talaq in one breath? One sitting, talaq, 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 and the matter is over, which sounds very inhuman. Unfortunately, in the Muslim Ummah, there are 3 types of talaq, not in Islam, in the Muslim community. One is talaq-e-bidah, talaq, talaq, talaq in one sitting, and talaq-e-dal. The second is talaq-e-hasan, that means a good talaq. You give talaq, wait for 1 menstrual period, again repeat the talaq, again wait for 1 menstrual period, again repeat talaq, talaq-e-hasan. The third type is talaq-e-ahsan, the best type, which is mentioned in the Quran, the Sahih Hadith, which is the correct type. In which, as I was mentioning, after all the procedures, try and sit together, if there's a problem, appoint an arbiter. After that, once the husband pronounces talaq, you have to wait for 3 menstrual periods. Wait for 3 menstrual periods, within the iddah, it's known as iddah. Within the 3 menstrual period, if you feel, oh, I give talaq to her, 5 days I realize I can't do without my wife, then you can. Again, live together, you can do ruju, no problem. But yet, after 3 months, you realize, no, we want to part. You can part, but on equitable terms. Don't do mudslinging. In the Indian court of law, you have to prove your wife is not good, the wife has to prove husband is not good. You have to do mudslinging. You have to wash the dirty linen in public. Islam is against that. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 230, 230 and 232, that when you part, part on good terms. Don't even take back the gifts which you have given. Don't do mudslinging. Don't try and prove, oh, she's very bad. She's done adultery, fornication, and he's very bad, and blah, blah, blah. Part on good terms. So in Islam, the 3 menstrual period is the iddah, is the waiting period, which is the trial period. If after 3 menstrual periods, then you part and you stay separate. This is the right procedure of talaq. Again, if you think after 2 years, oh, fine, what I did was wrong. Again, you can remarry the same woman. New nikah, new mahar. You can marry. New nikah, new meher. After 2 years. Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 232, do not prevent the woman from marrying their former husband. But again, if there's a problem, again the same procedures, again iddah, 3 period, give talaq, again you part, again you marry, after maybe 1 year, again you give talaq, Allah says maximum talaq thrice. After that, talaq is not gudda gudi ka khel. It's not doll's marriage, marry and part, marry and part. After that, you cannot remarry the same husband. Unless you marry somebody else, and in the course of time, if that person gives divorce, If the marriage is not compatible, then you can marry the husband who has given you triple talaq earlier. So this is the right procedure, brother. Come to your second question. What is the maintenance? In Islam, for a marriage to solemnize, there is mahar. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 4, that give to the woman in marriage a marital gift. Mahar is compulsory for a marriage to solemnize. And mahar depends upon the financial status of the would-be husband and wife. The Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 20, you can even give a mountain of gold. You can give any amount. So this mahar, if talaq takes place, if the mahar has not been given, the mahar has to be given. There's nothing like maintenance. Because in Islam, when a talaq takes place, divorce takes place, the husband goes in more financial loss than the woman. Because the husband has to forego the mahar. The mahar may be 1 lakh rupees, 5 lakh rupees, 10 lakh rupees, Allahu alam. Imagine if in talaq, the woman takes away the mahar, the husband will have to marry a new wife. Again, he has to give new mahar and then also pay maintenance. Then I have to give a talk on the man's rights in Islam. See, Allah is just. He's not unjust. So in Islam, when a divorce takes place, the man is in financial loss. Because in marriage, in the other Hindu culture, the woman gives dowry to the man. 1 lakh rupees, graduate. Engineer, 10 lakh rupees. Doctor, 50 lakh rupees. In the Indian culture. In Islam, giving or taking dowry forcibly, demanding is haram in Islam. Willfully, if the parents of the girl give some gifts, allowed. But demanding indirectly, my son likes to drive a Mercedes car, telling him Mercedes car for dowry, haram. So in Islam, the mahar is there. With the mahar money, what the girl gets from the husband, she can invest that money, she can keep it, she can give it to the mother, what she wants, she can do. So that itself is a financial loss. Now again, divorce takes place. She can marry another husband, gets new mahar. She gets new money. The poor husband has to give away to a new wife, mahar. And then you tell him, give maintenance. How will the poor chap survive? So in Islam, the woman is on the financial receiving end. And you can refer to my video cassette, Woman Rights in Islam, will give more details.